NYU professor.
NYU professor.
Thank you for coming here today. This is the third, I don't think we need a mic check here, right? Can everyone hear? This is really the third talk in the open forum season. And there's been three open forums so far on the topic of student debt. And Suzanne, if you could circulate these to everyone. Everyone knows. It's sort of in preparation for our National Day of Action, which is next week, April 25th. And there'll be a lot of solidarity actions around the country, and we'll be meeting here at 4 p.m. in Union Square. And the Occupy Student Debt campaign, which is organizing this, really sees it as the beginning of a political movement, and not just an economic reform movement. And I'll try and explain in my comments today why I think that is the case, at least. There are economic reform initiatives out there. There's even a bill in Congress right now, sponsored by a Republican, no less, that is asking for student debt forgiveness. And in the campaign, we tend to avoid the term forgiveness because it suggests that debtors have done something wrong and that they're seeking forgiveness and they have to be excused in some way. And we prefer to talk about a student debt jubilee. And the jubilee is something that will be announced and declared next Wednesday, 1T day here. Even if that bill was passed in Congress and there's zero chance of it passing, it would not be a bad thing. It would write off the current student debt burden, but it would do nothing to alter the system which generates the debt in the first place. It would do nothing to alter the higher education landscape, which entirely depends on funding through student debt. And that's what we have to do, really, to alter the system, whereby higher education is entirely dependent on student debt. And in doing so, we'll help to free young people from the impact of debt bondage on their political imagination. And that's why I see it as a political movement. Now, some of you know that neoliberalism is supposed to have died by now. A few years ago, a lot of us were proclaiming the death of neoliberalism. And that hasn't actually turned out the way we expected. And it's actually in education that you can see where neoliberalism has barely missed a beat at all. What has happened in that period of time in the last few years is that we've seen the transfer of fiscal responsibility from the state onto the private individual in education, which is a hallmark of neoliberalism. And we've seen that really increase at an extraordinary rate in the past few years or so. It's been going on for 30 years or so, but during the recession, it's really increased. And as a result, we've seen, you know, college costs go up. The only costs that have risen quite consistently throughout the recession, and with a corresponding skyrocketing rise in the student debt burden itself. So, the privatization of education is one of the places, the central place, where we can see this very tight relationship between Wall Street and various levels of government. And it's that very tight relationship that Occupy movement has been targeting in particular. In 2010, the government reorganized the student lending system and took responsibility for originating all federal loans. And as a result, what happened was that the state put its official stamp on the neoliberal funding formula. What it means is the government will no longer fund education, but it will compel students to fund education by giving them loans to do so, and by extracting unjustifiable profits from the loans themselves. It's a little peculiar for us to think about the government profiting from something, but it's a very good example of the government profiting from a public good, which is even more nefarious. Now, we usually think of the privatization of education in different ways. We think of it as a, you know, university-industry partnerships. We think about intellectual property licensing. We don't usually think of the student lending system as a privatization of education, but it is actually a very comprehensive way of doing that, especially because there are private individuals involved who are doing the funding and not necessarily corporations. So one of the consequences of the reorganization of 2010 is that in the public mind, people think that the government is entirely responsible now for all student loans, that the student loan problem, the student debt problem, is a government problem. This is not at all true. The majority of student debt is still held by private banks, and these private banks profit enormously when debtors default. So they seek out the kind of debtors who will default. The rate of issuance of private loans is far greater than the rate of issuance of federal loans. So in 15 or 20 years or so, the number of private loans will once again outstrip the number of federal loans. And lastly, there is this phenomenon called slabs, which is student loan asset-backed securities, which is the securitization of student loans, which is currently about a third of all student loan debt right now. So $300 or $400 billion worth of securities that are based on student loans. And what that means is that speculators are gambling on the odds of whether you are going to default on your loan or not. And that's what the gamble is all about. Now, the other source of misinformation has to do with the typical student debtor. In the public mind, the stereotype of the typical student debtor is a white student from a middle-class background who is paying for an education at a private, pricey university. And while it certainly is the case that the largest single student debts are racked up by individuals who are from that demographic profile, student debt has a disproportionate impact on low-income families and is magnified by the low-income status of students from these families. What that means is that as the price of public education rises, students from low-income families are priced out of public education and are increasingly pushed into the for-profit university sector, which is where 95% of students have loans, graduation rates are perilously low, and also where predatory lending and reverse redlining are rife. That is how the for-profit sector is actually subsists. Now, if you're from a family that has generations of college graduates behind it, the higher education landscape is pretty confusing anyway. Right, which colleges to go to, what financial aid packages are available. So it's confusing enough for families that have this kind of background. For first-generation college families, they have very little access to accurate information about colleges, very little access to accurate information about financial aid packages, and so invariably they are the easiest prey for the predatory lenders and the admissions counselors in for-profit universities who are out there to snare them. In addition, there are a lot of states, and most of them are in the Deep South, where community colleges don't have access to the federal loan system, or opt out. And as a result, and because they're in the Deep South, that has a disproportionate impact on African-American populations. And nationally, African-American populations have the least access to federal loans in general. So there's an impact of racialization here, which is also leans on class. Now, I want to just wind up by saying why I think that the debt abolition movement is not simply an economic reform movement, and why it's a political movement. This is a very important point, I think. One of the things that Occupy is focused on is how the financial manipulation of debt has been a very effective way of redistributing wealth. It's a very effective way of generating wealth for the 1%. What's often neglected a little bit, and what we have to focus on, is how the imposition of debt is also a very effective political instrument, an instrument of social control. Because an indebted citizenry is not a free citizenry. It's a citizenry whose future has been foreshortened by the threat of a ruined credit score. We've seen this. We've seen this in the mortgage, lending culture of the last century or so. Home ownership and long-term mortgage loans were pushed in the 1920s and 1930s explicitly as anti-socialist measures. To own a home and to have access to a loan during the Cold War years was a mark of anti-communist citizenship. This was explicitly promoted as national policy. And you were not a first-class citizen during those years unless you had a long-term relationship of debt with a bank. And if you consider how many, again, racialized populations were cut out of access to home loans, the idea of being a first-class citizen was one which was reinforced by that particular lending circumstance. I think the same is true for student loans to some degree. In the 1960s and 1970s, student radicalism became a kind of generational rite of passage. And if you consider how effectively mortgage debt has worked to curb the political agility of the population of homeowners, generations of homeowners, so too the rise in student debt, the student debt burden, has been a very effective way of dampening the insurgent student imagination in this country. If you want to try and prevent students from exercising their optional political imagination in radical ways, the easiest way of doing it is to saddle them with crushing debts from day one of college, to compel them to take on all sorts of jobs in order to stave off further debt, and lastly, to compel them to think of their education as a bargain for which they're trading their future wages, because that in essence is what the system requires students to do. So these are not conditions under which you can really cultivate a free critical mind, but they certainly are conditions that are serviceable for elites to prevent an educated radical citizenry from coming into being. And so those are the reasons, I think, and that's the kind of insights that we need to bear in mind if we want to think about how the student debt abolition movement is a political movement. It cannot simply be an economic reform movement in and of itself. It has to be a movement that will free up young people's minds from the very stifling impact of student debt burden. And like the best kind of abolitionism, it is a freedom movement, because it is a movement to free young minds from mental bondage. And as is customary in our Occupy student debt campaign meetings and rallies, we always invite people to step forward and talk about their student debt, if they have any student debt, because coming out about student debt is a very important part of the movement. So if there's anyone here who has student debt, wants to step forward and talk about it.
My name's Salvatore. I owe $60,000 right about now. With the interest and everything throughout the, throughout the years. I like when you talked about missions. And I was also in the military.
Uh-huh.
So missions to me is like army recruiting, you know? Like, you told me all these things, but when I went to classes. Like, you talk about, like, trying to get a job, you know, like, how the, you know, professor's supposed to work with you, how to get jobs, and after school, you know, after you got done doing the program, you were supposed to have job placement in certain schools. It never happened, you know? Mm-hmm. And then, all you really get is, like, Sally Mae calling you, like, every other day, like, hi, it's Sally Mae, you know, I'm like, all right, I got a D-ball, you know, like, just pass it on, and that's another, what, 5,000 every time you do that, every day, like, 3 to 6 months, you know? It's just horrible, you know? It's like, they get you to a point where it's like, you're this far over, you know? And, like, it's like, no goal, you know? Like, to me right now, it's like, what's the point of paying student debt, you know? I'm gonna continue, like, you know, paying into it for no reason, you know? Mm-hmm. I went to this one school, you're talking about the private schools that push you for jobs and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Be a medical assistant, and there's no market, you know? Every time I apply for a job, something like that, they would be like, well, we're hiring, you know, RNs. Mm-hmm. You know, and that, you know, that program alone was like $25,000, you know? For a, you know, this little 9-month program, I learned basic skills, but still, it's like, you know, $25,000, could have worked a lot more, and I could have, you know, could have put towards, you know, that debt towards something better, you know? Better education, definitely, you know?
And how do you feel when people who resent the student debt movement, how do you feel when people say that they blame you for taking on this debt?
Well, to blame people or blame students that, you know... Blaming the victim is absolutely ridiculous. To me, that's like telling somebody who lost somebody in the Twin Towers, like, oh, it's your fault, you know? It's like it's ridiculous. It's absolutely ridiculous because, like... Look at, like, the job market. There is no job market right now. It's horrible everywhere, you know? I moved back and forth from Jersey to Philly, like, trying to find work. Mm-hmm. And the only thing I can find is really is, like, construction jobs. Mm-hmm. Or, like, minute computer repair, you know? Mm-hmm. Like that. But, like, I'm a multimedia major. And I went to school to be an audio engineer.
Right.
And that's my heart. That's where my creativity is, you know? And I wound up having to go back to school because I couldn't find a job. You know, I pushed everywhere, you know, and have an excellent resume. I don't know, even with an excellent resume, you still can't find work. It's horrible.
So what would you like to see happen?
What I'd like to see happen? I like, you know, like, it should be more, I guess, like, more outlets, like, for student creativity towards job market, you know?
Uh-huh.
It would be great that, you know, if the students geared more towards, like, an artist or, mm-hmm. or a doctor, you know, like a web designer or something like mm-hmm. that, then the school should help, you know, get that student some kind of job placement while in school.
Right.
You know?
Yeah.
Instead of flooding up a time schedule where you're sitting there, you know, you're worrying about midterms, worrying about this class that has nothing to do mm-hmm. with your trade, you know? When that time could be, when you can be working, you know? And getting that experience needed for the job, you know?
I teach art, and I really love what I do. But around 2000, I started hearing my students say that they're tens of thousands of dollars in debt. And I knew that wasn't right, especially for an art student. Then, by 2010, it was $100,000 in debt. And just this week, I asked my students how they were doing. They're approaching $150,000 in debt for a master's degree, a master's fine arts. It's insane. It's insidious, as you said. And I feel really bad about it. I was doing something that I thought was cool and was good, and now I feel guilty about, and I always talk to my students for years about debt. That's one of the first things I say in every class. And to be on the defensive for a system that systematically puts people in debt, into bondage. There used to be things like indentured servants. The idea if you have to assume debt to do something. know, sell your child to work for somebody for 10 years. That was Charles Dickens' time. Well, we have that today. It's back. It's permeated throughout our society. It's not just the universities. It's the whole idea, if you want to be a part of this society, you have to be in debt. And it's wrong. And I think the students could be really important in making people understand how this system works.
No.
And students are always at the forefront. And I just want to support you.
Sure, I'll talk about my net. I work at NYU. I build master's student community, and I do that through events, and it's amazing because I'm also a student at NYU, and because I work there, I get to go with 100% tuition remission. But the government acts as if the value of my tuition is income, and so I have to take a loan because they take the very expensive value of my NYU education as if that's money in my pocket. So I'm going into debt, and I'm actually funding my own salary through my own loan debt, which is crazy. But I work with master's students every day who are trying to, you know, sort of just do the right thing. Go to school, you know, do something to, like, be somebody in the world that they want to be. And it seems that we've created a system here where we've found ourselves in a system here that in order to be part of the society, you have to be willing to shackle yourself to a lending institution, potentially for the rest of your life. And I see, you know, thousands of students in that situation that I care very much about every day. And so if there's, you know, it's my own situation is I get to go to a very expensive school for less money than anybody else off the street because I work there. So I'm surrounded by people who are worse off than I am, who are just really trying to contribute to society. And it breaks my heart because they know I've been through many graduation ceremonies where I'm like, congratulations, congratulations. And they're like, yeah, congratulations, I get to start paying it off. The job market isn't happening, and now I'm, you know, I know that this day of celebration really just means the beginning of loan statements arriving in my house. Oh, absolutely. I think that more and more places, like departments, are trying to commodify themselves, you know, try and guarantee employment, and you end up, but people, the funding goes more to, you know, commodified than uncommodified departments. I think that you see that where people are nervous about taking a degree in the humanities, for example, and that's it's a real crime, because instead of people saying, what do I want to do with my life, they're saying, well, I'm going to go into debt, how am I going to pay the bank? And that's not how to be part of the world, but that's what we found ourselves. Say that? Absolutely. You're taking somebody's imagination and you're shackling it to a ladder. So we're going to be here next Wednesday marking One Tea Day. $1 trillion in student loan debt right here at 4 o'clock in the park and nationally. If you don't know about it already, then please get the information from us. And if you'd like to join the Occupy Student Debt campaign, I'd be very happy to take email addresses and make sure that you're part of building this political movement that I know I personally think is incredibly important for the future for all of us.
80,000 people, the NYPD stopped and frisked. What's
going to
happen on
T-Day? So One T-Day, it's going to actually, I think a lot of things are going to happen. One of the things I'm really excited about is I hear that Sally Mae and some other bankers may be coming here to celebrate how rich they've become. And there may be some debtors that would like to have a conversation with them. So I think that might happen here. I don't know. I think there'll be a bunch of other surprises. But basically what I'm understanding about One Tea Day is this is, with $1 trillion of student debt, this is certainly not a day to celebrate unless you're the 1%. And so if the 1% would like to come and celebrate, maybe we can join them in the park and remind them of who's really paying. You know, if you borrow today, you're going to pay for the rest of your life. I don't know, I just keep hearing this idea of, like, I am not alone, you know? Student debt can really feel very isolating. You get a get an envelope in the mail at home. It's sort of threatening, right? Because it's like, hey or else. And so I hope, if anything happens on 1T Day, that people can come out of that isolation and join with other people that see this as an unjust situation and start making that political movement to make change. So that's what I think will happen.
I have a Google voice number, and like that's basically, I don't even have a regular cell phone service. I have a Google voice number, my name's not even attached to it. 2 days ago, I got a phone call from Sally Mae.
Get out.
Swear.
Sally really? Called you?
Yeah. Blew my mind away.
Yeah.
My what does she sound like?
Very angry.
But like, I just also want to know, like the information that you're also surfing with on your phone, like how exactly are they buying that information to find out exactly, like, that's my private, you know, that's all my personal information. Like,
you get sold to them by Google. Google will serve.
To government and corporations.
It's but I have nothing on my phone.
You're smart, dude. You know how smart
they are. Yeah, I know. It just blew my mind away when you were like...
Do you have email? Do you have Google email?
Yeah, I
have
Google email. But nothing in my email is attached to my name. That's what bugs me out.
But if you're in this... Yeah, I don't know.
One of my students said today that Sally Mae's his best friend, the only woman who hasn't left him in the last 3 years and guaranteed never to leave him. Thought that was a good line. We should use that.
Actually, what you're talking about in terms of the like, awakening, this political imagination, reminds me of something that happened a couple of years ago where I used to bring my dog to this rural park, and I would run into this woman like almost every day for a while, and she had just graduated from NYU, and she had $80,000 worth of debt. And some mornings, this is like 8 in the morning, she would be in the park with her dog crying. And it was very powerful because she had explained to me how she couldn't find a job, and she had had like some jobs here and there, and she finally had decided that the only way for her to get out of this situation was to become a teacher. But she needed to go back to school, right, to become a teacher, or else she could volunteer with special ed students for a period of time, which is what she ended up doing. Only she was a history major, she didn't really have much interest in being a teacher or working with special ed students, frankly, but that's what she committed herself literally to 20 years of that, just because of this $80,000 that she accumulated between the age of 18 and 22. And it's just such a sad situation. That was it for her, you know?
It really is a form of indentured servitude. You have to, I mean, and that's what's important about the politics of it.
It's worse than indentured, because indentured, if I remember from my history, indentured servitude lasted 5 to 7 years, you know?
Yeah.
This is much worse, you know? This is like 50 years for some people.
It's just totally shaping life choices.
Yeah.
Completely.
It's so sad. I mean, I think of right now, because my student loan debt was paid off about 20 years ago or so. But I remember it, and it was a lot. It was a lot. And I just remember what it prevented me from doing, and how it so just like grabbed my heart and crushed it, and like made me like make decisions that I know that I wouldn't have made if I hadn't, you know. And you know, the creative thoughts that were down the drain because of that. I mean, you know, they talk about, you know, it's hard to read a book when you're in a foxhole, you know. I mean, this is even worse than being in a foxhole, man. I mean, that sense of despair and apprehension and constant, you know, worrying about the next bill that's coming in the mail, and it's just horrifying, you know, and I really feel for, you know, for people
school or coming out of school now. It's crazy.
Much worse. Yeah. And you mentioned creativity and some other people. The idea of being creative, and I teach art, you know, but Aristotle said money's a form of social exchange. And one of my favorite artists is Joseph Beuys. And he talked about social sculpture, where everybody has to be creative. And they are creative in the way they live their lives, their daily lives. If you're not creative in the way you're at work, then you're a wage slave, you have a shitty job. Okay, if you're in poverty, your creativity is severely limited. We have a right to creativity. It's part of what freedom is. The idea of making choices, and this is, you said it beautifully, it precludes any choices on your part. You're stuck in a situation. Now you have maybe three choices of where you'll be in that situation, but that's not a real free choice.
I was at an event the other day, and someone asked me what I thought about this plan that if you have student debt and you go into military service, and then the government will wipe your debt clean. So I'm saying, so if you risk your life going into a war you think is illegal and unjust and inhumane, and you may or may not come home alive or intact, that's what's worth your student debt? So in what way? Like, what are the priorities that we're setting as a country? You know, if you are shackled to your debt, and your choices are either pay forever, mm-hmm. risk your life in battle that you may or may not, probably not, support, mm-hmm. and your government is saying that they'll spend instead of spending 3 months of the Pentagon budget on free education for everybody, let's just assembly line people out onto a battlefield and spend money out there.
Well, he's a veteran, and yeah, he doesn't have free education.
I have a general discharge. I have friends that are coming back now from Iraq, you know, did three tours. And what a lot of times what they don't tell you about the GI Bill is, yeah, they'll pay for, education, but they'll only pay while you're in service sometimes. And it depends, all depends on your contract when you go and sign up. So, you know, you got to read the fine print when you enlist. Because I got friends that are coming back with student loans that, you know, GI Bill is going to help, and they're getting denied. They're getting denied GI Bill. Because, because the fine print said that while you're in service, they'll mail you books, kind of like taking college, college online. Yeah, pretty much. So you can take the online course, they'll pay for your online course while you're in service, and, that's your funny GI Bill.
That's amazing. I mean, I just say that because both of my parents went to college on GI Bills.
Yeah.
And, it's mind-boggling that, well, in addition to that, my grandmother, who was a maid, paid for much of my father's education at NYU, saving money at the time that was possible.
Wow.
Now, you cannot do that, you know what I mean? And my father is able to go on to graduate school at Columbia, and pay for that, right? And he's a veteran of World War II. That's an entirely different situation.
Yeah, different trajectory.
Completely.
This is also stepping back from the Iraq war. I had a cousin that came back from Iraq. You couldn't get GI Bill to pay for squat. Every time he was trying to sign up for a program that he wanted, they wouldn't clear it.
Your father's situation after World War II, people don't realize. I mean, you can say what you want about Roosevelt, but he was our greatest socialist president. I know there's a lot of criticism within that framework. However, the middle class was built by the American government, not by private enterprise,
by unions,
not by the banking system.
By trade unions.
Is it not true?
Also by the labor movement.
Yes.
But the government and the labor movement.
But the idea of government banks giving loans for housing, for education, that was all part of it. Of course, I'm sorry. That was very important.
That was also, somewhat of a trade-off, if I'm correct, perhaps, in the sense that there was, a political movement at that time that was network, communism, socialism, were very much discussed publicly, not the same sort of secretive environment that we have today. Many of those ideas come up, and that was kind of like, well, we can, you know, keep people within this capitalist system by expanding the middle class. And that was what Andrew was also talking about the development of debt within that structure. Buy a house, you know what I mean? You're going to have your tiki-taki house in the suburbs, it's like all the others, and now you're going to have